Okay, can start. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Foreign Correspondent Club of Japan. My name is Pio D'Emilia. I have the honor and the privilege to moderate this debate, this, I would say, historical debate from two former Prime Minister of Japan, Koizumi Junichiro and Kan Naoto. In politics, miracles do happen. If you believe, if you think about 20 years ago, 15 years ago, these two people debating and very aggressively in the parliament, each other, you would not imagine that we would have them here debating a very important issue, nuclear power, and agreeing basically on that. So that is a very interesting development for Japan, for us, and I will personally thank you very much for being here today with us and to share your views and plans for the future. Now, before starting, I don't think they need any kind of introduction. You can, you know, everybody here knows about them. So I would not waste time, also because we have 10 minutes delay. What I really would like to stress is that this is a series that we are dedicating to the anniversary of the triple tragedy that hit Japan 10 years ago, the earthquake, the tsunami, and the nuclear incident in Fukushima. So may I ask everybody to give a thought. I wouldn't ask a minute of silence, but you know, we will have time for that. But please let us all remember that tragedy and what happened to the Tohoku people in Japan 10 years ago. Okay, so I would start. You want to translate this to them or no? It's okay?
I think it's okay. 大丈夫ね。大丈夫。あの、日本語の紹介の方を省略させていただきます。Please.
Okay, so we agreed that the first to speak today will be Koizumi Junichiro. And please, the microphone is yours.
Should
I speak for about 1 minute?
Yeah, yeah. あの、 どうぞ。
今日は原発の問題で菅さんと一緒になりましたけども、この原発の問題はね、与党も野党もないんですよ。全国民の関心事だし、これからの将来考えて原発なくした方がいいという立場も一緒だということで、 与野党を超えて右も左もないと、全国民の関心事ですから、お互い政党の枠を超えて、将来日本が原発ゼロで発展できるような、そういう国にまいしんしたいという気持ちでやってまいりました。
So we are here today to speak about the issue of nuclear power. I'm here together with Mr. Kan on this opportunity. This issue is not one which is different according to which political party you belong to. It is not an issue where there is either the government, the ruling, and the opposition parties. Rather, it is an issue which concerns the future of all people and indeed the whole future of Japan. And we are sharing the same position up here about the need to eradicate nuclear power, to shift away from nuclear power. This is an issue which goes beyond party lines, beyond left and right, and it is something which is an important priority for all people and indeed for the future of Japan to see how we can create this future of zero nuclear power. That's all.
He has changed.
変わりましたね。
今日はあの、 You can take his time.
あの、小泉さんのあのお時間もぜひお使いいただければ。今日はあの久しぶりにこの外国人記者クラブにお招きありがとうございました。特にあの小泉さんとはですね、この原発ゼロというか、あるいはあのさらに再生可能エネルギーということでは、まあいろんなところでもうこれまでもご一緒してるんですが、
まあ、こういう形で の一緒の討論会参加をちょっと初めてかなと思っております。先日予算委員会で私この問題を取り上げまして、まあ、後に話をさせていただきたいと思いますが、まあ、原発をゼロにするということに賛成の方は多いんですけれども、じゃあゼロにしたときに本当にそれで電力が足りるかということをまだ心配されている方があります。そして、その特に化石燃料を使わないと足らないんではないかと思われている方も多いんですけれども、私が計算をしてみたところ、再生可能エネルギー、まあ、特に、営農型太陽光発電というですね、日本には400万ヘクタールの農地がありますけれども、その農地の上でお米や麦や野菜を作りながらですよ、作りながらその上でその太陽光発電で電気を起こすと、私計算してみて、びっくりしました。計算式は簡単なので言いますと、1ヘクタールについて500キロワットのパネルを並べる、で大体1年間で1000時間の太陽が照ります。そうすると 500×、 つまり500キロワットかける1000、500キロワットかける1000かける400万ヘクタールですけど、400万、まあ、それちょっとやってみてください。そうすると2兆キロワットアワーということになります。今日本が使っている電力は年間1兆キロワットアワーですから、この太陽光を失礼しまして営農型太陽光発電だけでもですね、日本が今使っている電力の全てを賄うことが理屈上は理論上は可能だということが分かりまして、まあ、幸いにして今農林省がですね、逆に農業の方で高齢化が進み、あるいは離農が進んでいる中で農業も活性化し、そしてそれが再生可能エネルギーという形での電力の供給にもプラスになるということで、かなり積極的になっております。私はぜひですね、この農林省に先日も予算委員会で提案したんですが、名前を少し変えてもらいたい、それは農林水産再エネ省というのにしてもらいたい。で、何か皆さんびっくりされるかもしれませんが、200年前はですね、世界中のエネルギーは何で供給されてたかというと薪とか炭なんですよ。つまりは農村が供給してたわけです。それが石炭になり石油になり原発になって、もう一回今度はその 農地を使ってですね、そういう再生可能エネルギーが生まれる、まあ、ある意味では大変自然なことでありますので、そういう方向に、まあ、少なくとも日本は国土が比較的狭い中ではこの農地を使うというのは画期的なことでありますので、そのことをぜひですね実現したい、今日はそのことをちょっと話をする機会と思ってやってまいりました。以上です。
So today it is my first opportunity to be back here at the FCCJ in quite a while. I have had the opportunity to be together with Mr. Koizumi in various different events and so on, given our shared interest in zero nuclear power and renewable energy. But I think that this is perhaps the first time that we are together in an opportunity such as this, to be standing together in a debate or discussion directly together on this issue. The other day I had the opportunity to share some or to ask some questions in the budget committee of the Diet in regards to renewable energy. So I'd like to share just one of the points from that, if I may. Of course, there are many people in Japan who already agree that we need to shift away and shift to zero nuclear power. However, there are still many who have concerns about whether it would be possible to actually generate or provide sufficient electricity under those situations. There are people who think, for example, do we still need to rely even more on fossil fuels in order to generate enough to cover the demand. However, I actually calculated, and one of the issues I'm particularly looking or paying attention to recently is looking at farming photovoltaics, or what used to be known as solar sharing, referred to as well. And I calculated actually that if we look at the area of farmland in Japan, which is around 4 million hectares, and if we consider places where you can continue to be making, growing rice, vegetables, and wheat, and so on, but if you were to install solar panels in this kind of farmland within Japan, there would be a significant potential potential there. I was actually quite surprised at the results of my own calculation myself. But if it's said that per every one hectare, it can have panels of up to around 500 kilowatts per hour. And then if we look at per 1 year, there is around 1,000 hours of sunlight in every one of these locations. If you take the very simple calculation of 500 kilowatts, 1,000 hours, and then the 4 million hectares, this comes up to actually about 2 trillion kilowatts that can be generated if, of course, well, logically, if all of this could be used as well. However, the current demand or usage of electricity in Japan is actually around 1 trillion per year. So we can see that by this logic, if this kind of farming photovoltaics is introduced sufficiently, then that could even be enough to cover all of the electricity needs here in Japan. This is something that actually the Ministry of Agriculture is also promoting or very positive in regards at the moment as well. Given the issues which exist in Japan about the aging of farmers and the issues within the agriculture industry as well, looking at seeing this as a way to potentially revitalize that industry, which is having its challenges now as well. So they see that using this farmland both for agriculture but also for contributing to the supply of generation of electricity can be a plus for both of these aspects. So this is something that the ministry is pushing for, but I would like to maybe suggest that they could even change their name from just the Ministry of Agriculture to also including the Ministry of Agriculture and Renewable Energy as well. If we look at the change of the different kinds of energy that people have been using, if we look at 200 years ago where it was mostly, you know, wood and so on, then we've gone through the transitions to coal, to oil, to nuclear power. I think it's very natural indeed that human beings will use their wisdom to go to the next stage of using renewable energy as well. Japan is a country which only has a very small area of land, of course. Therefore, utilizing this kind of agricultural areas or farmland in this way, I think, would have a significant impact. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Maybe this is a good suggestion for Koizumi Sensei-san. He can lobby inside the government to change this ministry.
ぜひこちらのご提案の方も小泉先生の息子さんにもぜひいろいろと伝えていけたらと思います。
Okay, usually the moderator asks a couple of questions just to warm up, but I don't think that we need this today. There are a lot of people here, so I will certainly give the floor right away to the colleagues. We have also some written questions that have arrived, but let's prioritize the people in the room. And the first question goes to our President Isabel Reynolds. Please come to the microphone and state your affiliation.
Thank you.
Isabel Reynolds from Bloomberg. I was wondering how both of you would characterize the reasons for the resistance to getting rid of nuclear power in Japan. Is it fear of not having enough options for energy? Is it some people talk about the issue of having a quick path to nuclear weapons if one day Japan decided to have nuclear weapons? What do you see as the motivation for it?
お二人に質問をしたいんですが、日本で、原子力原発をやめることに対しての抵抗は、なぜあるのかということなんですけれども、例えばよく言われる、説としましては、例えば、あらゆる選択肢を残したいということ、複数の選択肢を残したいということも言われますし、将来的にはまた核兵器を生産するような選択も残したいということも言われるんですけれども、何が一番の抵抗の理由になっていますでしょうか。
どうですか。私はですね、本質的にはもう抵抗の理由はないと思ってます。もちろんかつてはですね、あるいは中曽根さんなどが原発を進められた時代には、日本においてもですね、場合によっては核武装ができるような能力は維持したいというのがあったかもしれませんが、現在、そこまで考えている政治家は、おられるかもしれませんが、ほとんどいないんではないかと。で、今、原発を言っている勢力は、いわゆる原子力村と言われる人たちですけれども、いわば既得権益を守るために言っていると。つまりは、もうですね、今さら新しい原発を作っても、価格が3倍ぐらいになってますから、採算が合わないことは分かっている、あるいは使用済み燃料の処理に がきちんとできないことも分かっている。しかし そういうものを前提として中国じゃなかった、関西電力の事件でもそうであるように、いろんな利権がもう全部に絡まっているものですから、そういう構造を維持したいがために、原発をまだこの使おうというですね、勢力が残っている、そういうふうに私は見ております。
So I think that fundamentally there really is no reason to resist moving away from nuclear power. Perhaps in years gone by, for example, during the Nakasone period, there may have been more who were wanting to maintain the capacity to potentially develop nuclear weapons or nuclear arms in the future. However, I would say that while there may be still a few, it would be almost no politicians in Japan who still see that as one of the issues. However, I think what is really the key there is in regards to the forces which are continuing to promote nuclear power is what is known as the nuclear village, and them wanting to protect their existing privileges or interests in regards to that. If we look at how much it would cost to construct new nuclear power plants now, it would be around 3 times the cost of what it were or what it was in the past. So we can see that just from the cost or economic perspectives, it really is not something which can be justified. On top of this, we also know that we do not have any way to deal with spent fuel, for example. But despite the fact that there are these issues which are very clear, there are still, as we've seen, you know, in the incidents in with the KEPCO and so on as well, this intertwining of interests and wanting to maintain the existing structures which are already in place. This is the reason that there is indeed still these forces resisting.
小泉先生、
原発に関わってきた会社、また学者、個人、やっぱり生涯をかけてこの原発取り組んできたわけですね。それをやっぱりなくしたくないという気持ちなんでしょう。いわゆる既得権ね、そういう勢力はかなりありますから、日本の全電源の約 30% 程度は原発会社が供給していたわけですから、そういう生涯かけてやってきたものを離したくないという気持ちがあるんでしょうね。しかしこれは全体国民の多数はできれば原発なしでやっていこうという考えの方が多いわけですから、そういうことを考えますと、何かことをやろうとせならばですね、賛成反対必ずあるわけです。しかし今原発をこれからもやっていこうというのは、私は日本国民全体から見れば少数派だと思っています。民主主義の世の中ですから、いずれはその原発なくしていこうという多数派がさらに多くなって、日本は原発でやっていこうという姿を見せたいという勢力が圧倒的多数になると思ってやっております。
I think indeed when we consider the companies, the researchers or individuals who had put their efforts into nuclear power, into developing this over the years, we can see that they have this sense of, you know, not wanting this to be gotten rid of, you know, after having first of all put everything into that and also having the different privileges which exist as a result of those structures as well. And these kind of forces or this present is indeed rather significant, rather large. When we consider that, you know, in the past the nuclear power companies were you know, controlling around 30% of Japan's energy, of course, this is something considerable, and it's not something that they want to be gotten rid of easily, shall we say. However, if we look at the majority of people in Japan, it is clear that the majority of people do want to move away from nuclear power. Of course, any time that you want to do something, to change something, there will always be people who are for and people who are against. That will always be the situation. And I really believe, truly, that we will be seeing in the future a situation where this majority of people who are wanting to move away from nuclear power here in Japan will be growing even larger and growing stronger, and the number of people who see that there is a future for new nuclear power in Japan will indeed only be a minority. Therefore, as we see the majority against nuclear power growing larger, then Japan will indeed be able to show itself as a country moving to zero nuclear power.
Next question. Bradley.
Bradley Martin from Asia Times. President Biden has an energy policy that includes doing research in advanced nuclear concepts, not the old traditional type of plant that you built over faults in Japan and that blew up on you, but brand new things, smaller in many cases, using nuclear fuel as spent fuel as a fuel, not producing spent fuel. There are all kinds of research angles going on in there. You'll find them in Asia Times. I'd be happy to send you the articles by our science columnist, Jonathan Tenenbaum, who's just starting a new series today on Biden's program. So I'm wondering why you use such a broad term, eradicate nuclear. I think that I ask you, aren't you leaving behind some chances to go way beyond what you've ever thought of doing? Thank you.
Thank you.
アジアタイムズのマーティンと申します。バイデン政権の、エネルギーの政策の中には、従来の原発ではなくて、新しい、新型、または小型の原子炉などの研究というものが、その政策の中には含まれています。これは福島で爆発したような古い原子炉ではなくて、新しい小型のものなどについての研究なんですけれども、こちら私が所属しているアジアタイムズの中でもシリーズ化として掲載されていますのでご興味があればお送りいたしますが、お二人がその原発原子力そのものをやめるというすごく広いことではなくて、こういったような新しいことを否定するということは、ある意味で新しい可能性も否定しているようなことにはなりませんでしょうか。
新しいこと、それは原発なくして発展できる国づくりですよ。現に2011年、10年前に福島事故が起こりました。放射能が拡散された。それまで54基日本の原発あった。2011年3月から2013年9月まで約2年間54基あった原発はたった2基しか動いてなかった。日本はで2013年から18年、5年間、去年からちょっと何か記憶出したけど、5年間、ゼロ、日本の原発ゼロ。その間、北海道から九州まで、一日も停電ない。すでに日本は原発ゼロでもやっていけるっていう、証明しちゃったんですよ。なぜこれを続けないのかと。不思議でしょうがないんです。なおかつ、産業廃棄物を処理する会社があります、日本は。ビル解体とかね、家電製品とか、古くなったものを処分する。その処分する会社は、自分で処分場を確保しない限り、その産業廃棄物ね、いわゆるゴミです。処分場を作らない限り、産業廃棄物の会社、できないんです。都道府県知事局を下ろさない許可を。原発みたいないです。産業廃棄物どころじゃないですよ、危険性は。なおかつ処分場がない。それでどうして政府は原発を認めてるのか、これ私には理解できないです。しかも実際的にゼロでも停電なしやっていける証明しちゃってるんですか。これ一日も早くしなきゃいかんと、そういう考えで今原発ゼロ運動を始めています。
You mentioned about this, research into new things. However, we have completely seen that it is impossible to get rid of nuclear power and utilize new things as a way to provide our energy instead. If we look at the time since the disaster, of course, which occurred 10 years ago in 2011, which led to the spread of radioactive materials and so on, at that time, there were 54 nuclear reactors here in Japan. And we're following that disaster from the period of March 2011. 2011 until September 2013 for just over 2 years. Of these 54 reactors, only two were operating. Following that, from the years of 2013 to 2018, for 5 years, there was zero nuclear power plants operating here in Japan. It's just since around a year ago that there has been some small amount of restart. However, even during that period with zero nuclear power, there was not a single blackout anywhere in Japan as a result, right from Hokkaido down to Kyushu. We have already proved that it is indeed possible to get by and have sufficient electricity here in Japan without nuclear power. So I really cannot understand why there would be an insistence upon going back to using this as well. A further point which is important is also to look at the issue of waste. If we consider companies which are dealing with the treatment or disposal of industrial waste in Japan, such as that which comes out after taking down buildings or former electric appliances and so on. According to the laws in Japan, these companies can only receive their permits and so on if they have secured or created their own disposal sites of this waste in the first place. The kind of waste that we're talking about for nuclear power is on a completely different level of danger. However, we still have no solution, no location in terms of the disposal of the waste from these plants as well. Therefore, I really cannot understand why it is that permission is given for nuclear power plants when there is no solution, no decision made about what to do with this waste for them. We have already proven in reality that Japan can get by with zero nuclear power and without having any blackouts or shortages of electricity. Therefore, I truly believe that this is the path that we need to move down as soon as possible.
数年前ダボス会議でビル・ゲイツ氏に短時間この件で話をしました。で、私は小型だからといって放射性廃棄物が出ないわけではないので、特に原発に、しなければいけない理由は話を聞いても分かりませんでした。あとは今小泉さんが言われたことと同じで、つまりは廃棄物問題を解決できていないわけですから、それが再生可能エネルギーであればその問題はありませんので、わざわざ原発に戻る必要は全くない、こう考えています。
Several years ago, I had the opportunity to speak for a brief amount of time with Bill Gates about this very issue, these small reactors, small so-called nuclear power plants and so on at Davos. And at that time, even hearing his explanation, you know, of course, we see that there, even with these smaller reactors, it is not that they get rid of any, you know, radioactive waste or any radioactive materials being part of the issue there as well. That issue is still at hand even in these kinds of reactors. So really, even after hearing those explanations, I cannot see any reason that we need to go back to nuclear power plants, nuclear power. On top of that, I would also say the same as Mr. Koizumi has said as well. Without yet having resolved the issue of waste, then I really cannot see why this is something that we would go back for when we do not have to deal with this issue of waste, how to dispose of the waste and so on, if we are shifting to renewable energy instead.
If I can follow up on his question, last question, is your opposition to nuclear power only for the present nuclear, the way of nuclear power now, which is fiction? Would you be also theoretically against fusion?
まあ、一つ補足で同じような質問なんですけれども、まあ、今現在存在しているような原発には反対だけれども、こういったような将来にまた違う形で発電するような原子力の方は、まあ、それも反対なのか についてお願いいたします。
それは反対です。もちろん自然エネルギーでやっていけるのにどうして金のかかる、しかも安全でないものをやる必要があるのかいうことですから、どんな新しい原発ができようともですね、コストはかかるわけですよ。無限にある新エネルギーを使った方がはるかにいいと思っております。日本は特に世界の中でも太陽光ある、水力ある、風力ある、もう自然に恵まれた国ですよ、自然エネルギーに。これを利用しない手はないと思っています。
Yes, indeed. Whether it is the one, the kind of plants that we already have or these other kinds in the future, I do not see that there is any need to rely on this kind of technology, which is, of course, extremely costly and also has the safety issues concerned as well. There is just not a need to rely on this as well, even if there were these new kinds developed as well, different from what we have until now. When we consider, for example, the potential of renewable energy is indeed unlimited. Here in Japan and also globally, we have solar, we have water, we have wind, we are blessed with this nature. So to not use that and to try and rely on nuclear power, no matter what form it is developed in, I do not think is necessary.
Kan-san?
全く小泉さんと同じです。ただ例えば核融合とかですね、いろんな研究が今でも進んでますので、それは新しい何かが将来生まれるかもしれません。しかし少なくとも発電というですね、電力を起こすことにそんな危険なものを使う必要は全くない。そう思ってます。
I have indeed the same position. Of course, there is various research, including into nuclear fusion and so on as well. And this is, kind of research which may lead to something which can be useful in the future. However, if we look at what we should be using for generating electricity, there is just no reason at all that we should be using something which poses such risks and dangers for the purposes of electricity.
Thank you very much. There are two ladies that want to ask. Go. First and then...
公共ラジオ局ラジオフランスとリベラシオン新聞の西村と申します。よろしくお願いします。お二人に質問させていただきます。福島第一原発の中に、または福島第一原発の周りに行くと、いかにひどい事故であったことが誰でも分かると思います。それでも日本全国、あるいは福島県でも原発推進派の方は未だに残っています。なぜこの事故の影響を受けた全ての日本人は原発反対派にならなかったのでしょうか。
My name is Nishimura. I have a question for both speakers. If you visit either on site at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant or the surrounding areas as well, anybody can see indeed truly how terrible, how awful this disaster which occurred was. However, throughout Japan and also even within Fukushima Prefecture, there are still people who are promoting nuclear power. I would like to ask why you think that despite the fact that all Japanese people experienced this disaster, that there are still people who are pushing for nuclear power.
今のご質問ね、私もそう思ってですよ。ドイツは日本の福島の原発事故を見てゼロに踏み切ったんですよ。日本目の当たりに事故を見ながら、悲惨な、まだやろうとしてる。これ理解できないですね。主義でしょうがないんですよ。やればできるのになしてやらないんだ。
I have exactly the same question as you have just posed as well. Germany saw what happened here in Japan after Fukushima and made the decision to move to zero nuclear power. However, here in Japan, despite the fact that it happened right here, it happened right in front of everybody's eyes, there are still people who are trying to push nuclear power. This is something that I simply cannot comprehend and is something that I just cannot see the reason for that.
全く同意見です。
Exactly the same opinion.
Okay, Kan-san and Koizumi, but you have to fight a little bit because otherwise you are going to make a new party here. We start the Kan Koizumi party and we close the doors.
お二人全く同じご意見というのはいいことなんですけども、ぜひもう少し議論などもぜひしていただければと思います。すべて同じ意見ですと、一つの政党を作るんじゃないかということね。
どうぞどうぞ。
シンガポールプレスホールディング日本特派員のフーと申します。今日は本当に与と野と野と与と一緒にいるっていうのはとても嬉しいことで、ノー311ノー原発ですね。ただ私が思うのはやっぱり一つのことを起こったっていうことは反省しなければならないんですね。まず菅先生に質問します。当時首相である菅先生はどういうふうに今思い出すと10年前何が一番いけなかったかっていうのは、コンパクトで一番見に行った時に一番インパクトがあることって何ですか。教えてください。そして小泉 先生ですけれども、もし小泉先生が当時首相であれば何をやればいいと思いますか。またはその後、今は安倍さん、安倍元首相がオリンピックはいわゆる福島アンダーコントロールであるということはどう思いますか。後輩である安倍元首相に何か反発な言葉もしあれば言ってください。よろしくお願いします。
My name is Fu of Singapore. First of all, I would like to say it's very impressive having both of you representing both the former ruling and opposing parties at the time with this common message, no 311, no nuclear power. I have a question for each of the speakers separately. The first, of course, when a disaster like this happens, there needs to be a full looking back on what actually occurred and addressing those issues as well. So my question first for Mr. Khan is, as the Prime Minister, at the time of the disaster, when you look back, if you would choose one thing that perhaps you should have done differently or one thing which was not done well at the time, if you could share that. And the question for Mr. Koizumi is, if you had been Prime Minister at the time, what you would have done differently, particularly when we see, you know, your junior within the party, Mr. Abe, making the statement in the calling for the Olympics about Fukushima being under control. If you could also speak about how you see his statement.
Okay, Kan-san first. Hi.
実は福島原発事故というのはですね、緊急用電源がもう少し高いところにあれば少なくともああいう形では起きなかったんです。じゃあなぜそんなに低いところにあったか、あるいは GE が前に作った時の設計図そのままなんですね。でアメリカは海のそばに、あまり原発はありません、川のそばです。でどちらかというと竜巻が怖いんですね。ですからその地震が多くて津波が多い、ところにわざわざですね、一番低いところに緊急用電源を置いたんです。でこれは裁判でも出てます。もう事故が起きる前にそういう指摘があったにもかかわらず、まあ大丈夫だろうと言って放置したんです。ですから他の原因でもちろん原発事故が起きる可能性はまだまだありますけれども、まあ、少なくとも東電があるいは他の電力もそうですが、そういう地震とか津波を考えないでそういう設計をやったということは、やはりこの原因の非常に大きな理由だと、そういうふうに見てます。
When we look at the Fukushima disaster, we saw the fact that the emergency power supplies was built on a very low area within the plant was something which meant that there was indeed, it contributed greatly to the disaster. If that had been located in a higher area of the plant, we would not have seen a disaster on the same kind of scale. And well, why is it that it was allowed to be built with the emergency power on such a low-lying area as well? The reason is that GE's plans for this nuclear power plant were just used exactly as they were without taking into consideration the different factors here in Japan as well. In the United States, nuclear power plants are generally not built as close to the ocean. They have different risks other than earthquakes and tsunamis, but more looking at risks of tornadoes and so on is the case in many of the locations where nuclear power plants are built in the United States. However, in the case of Japan, it is of course clear that there are the risks of earthquakes and tsunamis in these kind of prone areas. It was also clear, and this is something which has come out in the documentation and so on in lawsuits following the disaster, that indeed there were warnings or there were indications before the earthquake, before the disaster, that measures should have been put in place to build this in higher areas, for example. However, nothing was done by the utility company, by TEPCO, in regards to this as well. Of course, even today, we still face these kinds of risks of disasters occurring in other locations where there are nuclear power plants as well. And so therefore, the fact that TEPCO and the other utility companies did not think about these risks and did not take the necessary measures in the process of building their nuclear power plants, I think was one of the significant causes which contributed to the scale of the disaster.
小泉先生、私が総理だったらどうするかっていうんですけどね、もちろんやめてますよ、すぐ。私は安倍さんにね、事故の後一緒にゴルフやったんですよ。歩きながらね、経産省に騙されんだよ、騙されてんだぞと、原発安全、コスト安い、クリーンエネルギー。そしたらね、なんて答えるかと思ったらね、苦笑して何にも答えないんで、それっきりなんだけど、やっぱり経産省の言い分を信じてたんだろうな。私も当初、起きる前は原発安全だ、コスト安い、 CO2 出さないクリーンエネルギーって推進論者の信じたんですよ。それは自分なりに勉強してみて、これ全部嘘だ、分かったから転換してんだよ、うん、よく抜け抜けた頭のいい計算者の人たちがね、こういう嘘を言ってたなと。過ちは改めればいいなと思ってんだけども、まだ改めてないね。残念で仕方がない。
Well, if I had been a prime minister at the time, you know, of course, I would have looked down after this as well. Following the disaster, I had an opportunity. Actually, I was playing golf with Mr. Abe and we were walking along. And at the time, I said to him, you must not be fooled by METI and their claims that nuclear energy is safe, it's cheap and it's clean. But his response to that, he just laughed somewhat and sort of brushed this comment away, actually.I myself had believed what METI said about nuclear power plants prior to the disaster as well. These facts that saying that nuclear power is safe, saying that it's very cost effective or it's cheap, and saying that it's clean in terms of its CO2 as well. However, after the disaster occurred, I studied, I researched myself, and I came to learn that indeed each of these points were lies. You know, I had been fooled by these lies of METI over the years until that as well. I think it's very important for us to, when a mistakeHas occurred to acknowledge that and to redress that, but that is not what has happened.
Can I just make a short follow up to Nishimura's question? Do you think that in the fact that there are still people in Japan and authorities that are pushing for nuclear, there is also a responsibility from the media in Japan? Now we are approaching the 10th anniversary, and I can feel that most of the international press is.Mentioning the Fukushima accident, while in Japan is more, of course, there are many more deaths on the earthquake and the tsunami. Fukushima accident is not so much mentioned nowadays. Do you think there is a responsibility by the Japanese mass comi?
一つ先ほどの質問 の, 追加の補足なんですけれども、やはり今でも日本の中で原子力を推進しようとしている勢力があるということに対して、メディア、マスコミの責任もあるというふうに思いますでしょうか。と言いますのは、まあ、今もうすぐで10周年を迎えるわけなんですけれども、海外の報道を見ますと、やはり福島の原発事故にフォーカスしたような報道がたくさんあると思いますが、日本のメディアの方を見ますと、福島の事故よりより地震、そして津波、もちろんたくさんの死者は出たのであれなんですけれども、福島のことよりも地震と津波の方が日本のマスコミでは報道されているように思います。日本のマスコミにもそういったような責任はあるというふうに思いますでしょうか。
原発に関しては非常に大きな責任があると思います。ただその背景にはですね、東電をはじめ電力会社自身がかつては総括原価方式といってですね、たくさんの広告をいろんなメディアに出してました。面白い話を言えば、東電は電気をあまり使わないようにしようという広告まで、出してたんですね。で、つまり普通であれば自分が売るものを使わないようにしようなんていう広告を出さないんですが、広告を出すことによってその新聞やテレビ局に対して原発の反対的な論調は出さないようにという、そういうこのプレッシャーをある意味でかけてたということです。ですからやっぱり今もそうですが、今日も朝の新聞を見てきました。日経新聞はかなり変わりました。しかし読売新聞は相変わらず変わってません。それは広告の量がどうかまでは言いませんけども、メディアの責任は非常に大きいです。
I think that the media, when it comes to nuclear power in Japan, does indeed have a very large responsibility. And of course, in the background, the reason to this is the huge amount of investing in advertising in the media by TEPCO and the other utility companies as well. To say one perhaps interesting anecdote in regards to this is TEPCO was actually investing a lot of money into placing ads encouraging people to use less electricity. It seems somewhat ironic that they would be advertising for less of what it is that they are trying to sell. But by placing these kind of advertisements in the newspapers or television, it was a way to put pressure on the media to not have so much discussion about or being against nuclear power, for example. If we look at the situation today, I think that the media also has a very significant responsibility in regards to this. The Nikkei, I would say, has rather changed. If we look at today's Nikkei, for example, there is quite a difference we can see here. But Yomiuri, I would say, is exactly the same as it always has been. I wouldn't state, perhaps, I'm not sure about the advertising numbers there, but that is the current situation. So yes, the responsibility of the media in Japan is great.
Yeah.
それはマスコミも賛成するマスコミもあるし反対するマスコミもありますから、それはまあどうこういうわけじゃないけども、しかし反対の立場を進めていって、私自身はいずれ国民大多数の賛成によって原発ゼロの国づくりを進めていきたいなと思いますから、まあ何やっても反対賛成ありますから、それを乗り越えていかなきゃいかんと思ってます。
Well, in regards to the media, there is of course some media which is promoting or for nuclear power and some which is against as well. So it's perhaps difficult to make a blanket or an overall statement in regards to that. But when we are looking at this position of being against nuclear power, as I am myself, I think that as we are seeing the majority of people here in Japan having this position, moving towards this path of zero nuclear power, we will be seeing this being shaped as well. This is indeed, I think, what we will be moving towards in the future from now as well.
Andy?
This is Andy Sharp from Nikkei Asia Review, or Nikkei Asia Now, sorry. Two questions for both of you. Do you see any changes for nuclear power strategy under the Suga administration? And are you happy with the direction of the current discussion for the new strategic energy plan? I believe it has about 30 to 40% of thermal and nuclear combined. So your views on the Suga administration's nuclear policy and the overall plan, please. Thank you.
日経アジアナウのシャープと申します。2つほどお二人に質問がありますが、まず1つ目は、今の菅政権の中でその原子力に関する戦略、の方針では変化は見られているのかということがまず1つ目の質問です。そして2つ目の方なんですけれども、その政府の新しいエネルギー戦略、エネルギー計画の方では、確か 40% から 30% から 40% が原子力も単価力で含まれているというふうに伺っていますが、その新しいエネルギー戦略、エネルギー計画についてのコメントをお願いいたします。
菅政権は先の所信表明では、いわゆるカーボンニュートラルは言いましたけれども、それをどういう形で実現するかは、その場では触れられませんでした。しかし多くの自民党関係者は、それを実現するためには原発の再稼働や新設が必要だと、それをいわば口実にして原発に戻ろうとしていますので、やはり今の菅政権もですね、そういう大きな流れにあるかなと思っております。
First of all, in regards to the Suga administration, of course in his policy speech he made the statement of moving to carbon neutral. However, he did not say any detail about how he intends or plans to realize this as well. If we look at within many of the members of the LDP, they are saying or believing that in order to do this they need to either restart or have new construction of nuclear power reactors as well. So in a way, this statement or the policy for carbon neutral is being used as an excuse to go back to nuclear power by these people as well. So I would say in that regards, in that respect, we are not seeing changes under the Suga administration.
また現在のエネルギー基本計画でも、原発比率は20から22ということを菅政権は言っているわけで、場合によってはそれをさらに目標を引き上げるつもりかもしれません。しかし現実はですね、先ほど申し上げましたが、この10年間で原発の比率というのはわずか 3% なんですね。そして、コストは高くなっている。ですから私はですね、これ以上原発を増やすことは経済的にも成り立たない、だから早くですね、菅政権もそれに気がついて原発ゼロに向かうことが 望ましいと思っています。
And in regards to the new strategy or the new energy plan as well, I think at the moment they are stating within this plan to have around 20 to 22% of the energy or electricity to be provided by nuclear power, or in some cases even a higher number than that. If we look at the reality over the past 10 years, as demonstrated in this graph as well, it has actually only been around 3% which has been nuclear power throughout the past decade as well. On top of this, we are seeing the increasing costs of nuclear power. Therefore, it is really not feasible even from an economic perspective to have this increase or new construct of nuclear power here in Japan. So I just hope that Mr. Suga will indeed realize this soon and make the shift to zero nuclear power.
最近の新聞でしたかね、何新聞か分からなかったけどもね、新聞の報道で、東電はね、この福島の事故の損害賠償、これ自分の金じゃできませんと、政府支援してくださいと言って、もう一つ安全対策、これもあの事故後非常にコスト高くなった、東電だけじゃできないから政府支援してくださいと。もう一つ廃炉、これも廃炉も自分たちの金だけじゃできない、支援してくれと。今まで原発でコスト安いって言ったんだよ、コスト高くなっちゃったんだよ、みんなやる必要ないんですよ、迷惑のことやってんだ、一番金かかるんだよ、安全でもないというのは分かってるの、何よりも核のゴミ捨て場所ないんだから、こういう当たり前のことをね、よくもあの優秀な頭の人たちが経営者もやるなと思ってんだ、不思議だよ。
Recently, in a newspaper article, I'm unsure which paper it was in, but there was this article which was outlining that TEPCO is saying, well, first of all, the money which is needed to cover the different compensation claims and so on, they do not have enough funds themselves, so asking the government to support them to put up the money for that. In regards to safety measures as well, because since the disaster, the costs for safety measures in the plants has increased so much, they're also asking for government support to cover that. And also the costs for decommissioning the plants as well is something that TEPCO cannot do just with its own funds. So it's saying also, please government support us for that as well. When we see the way that the costs for nuclear power have increased on such a scale and that they are not able to cover this themselves, we can see that, well, they're just trying to do something which is completely unnecessary. It's something that we know it's not safe. We know that it's expensive. We also don't have any place to dispose of the waste which comes out of that. It's something which is so obvious, and yet there are people who should be so smart, people who are such smart people who are still pushing forward and trying to do this. It's something that I just cannot comprehend.
I have about 8 or 9 questions from people who are attending online, so I don't want to avoid any question from the floor, but please, these are the last 2 questions from the floor, okay? And I have Khaldun, and okay, 3, I think. Make it.
では会長から3つほど質問を受けたから、またオンラインの方でもいくつか届いていますので、その後もお伺いいたします。
Thank you for coming today, Khaldun Asari, for Emirates News Agency and Arab News. They are from Saudi Arabia and UAE that provide Japan with over 60 or 70% of its oil. So your dependence on oil is very important for your energy needs. And do you think the oil should be a main factor in the new energy policy? And the specific question to Prime Minister Khan, I think after the nuclear disaster, you were about to announce all Tokyo people to flee. Is that right? What is your comment on this? And I can't help but I ask Prime Minister, former Prime Minister Koizumi, this question, sorry. During the Iraq war, you said that you supported the war because on the basis that Iraq was developing nuclear weapons, which was not the case. So do you have any reflection on that decision? Thank you.
はい、アザリと申します。サウジそして UAE の、 ニュースなどを報道しているものです。その意味でいくつか質問があります。まずサウジと UAE はやはり日本も石油という意味で、非常に関係の深い国なんですけれども、今後の日本のエネルギーの中には石油というのはどういうような役割を果たすべきなのかということがまず一つ目のお二人への質問です。そしてカン先生には事故が起きた後にですね、東京の住民も避難させるというようなお話が当時あったかと思いますが、それについてのコメントがあればお願いいたします。そして小泉先生にはイラク戦争のことについてお伺いしたいと思うんですけれども、当時はイラクが核兵器を開発しようとしている、大量破壊兵器を開発しようとしているという理由でその戦争を支持されていたかと思いますが、その後それがそうではなかったということが明らかになりました。それについてもしコメントできることがありましたらお願いいたします。
石油というのは、この、数十年間世界の中心的なエネルギー源であったわけですが、私は将来の方向としては、CO2 の問題もありますので、基本的には化石燃料、石油を含む化石燃料は全て使わないようにすると、そしてそうでない再生可能エネルギー、つまりは太陽光や風力、バイオマスで全てのエネルギーは賄うべきだと。
First of all, in regards to oil, of course, in the previous decades, oil has formed a very central source for energy. However, in regards to the future direction, when we consider the issues of CO2 as well, I think that basically we need to be moving away from using fossil fuels, including oil, and rather than this, to be shifting to having all of our energy needs through other renewable forms, including solar, wind, and biomass.
また事故が起きたとき、私の頭の中に浮かんだのは、小松左京さんの書かれた日本沈没というですね、日本が全部沈没して、日本人全員が海外に逃げ出さなければなくなる、それが頭に浮かびました。実際にはですね、事故が発生して2週間後に、近藤俊介さんという原子力委員会の委員長からですね、最悪の場合、特に4号機がいろいろ危なかったんですが、250キロ圏、これは東京も含む約5000万人が住んでいるところですが、その範囲からの避難が最悪のケースでは必要になるというこのコメントをいただきました。そういう意味でですね、事故の時にやはりそのことが頭に入れながら、例えばギリギリのところで東電が撤退するといったときに、それを撤退はダメだと言って私が止めたのも、その最悪の状況、つまりは5000万人の人たちが逃げ出しなきゃいけならないような状況に至らないためには、本当に命がけでもその場で踏みとどまってほしいと、そう考えたからそのことを申し上げました。以上です。
And as for the second question, when the disaster first occurred, the first thing which came to my mind was the book which is called, or the name translates to Japan Sinks, which is a scenario in which all of the people of Japan are forced to flee overseas following the disaster. In reality, 2 weeks after the disaster, I called for the preparation of a scenario of what the worst case scenario would be. This was prepared by Mr. Kondo Shunsuke, who was at the time the chair of the Japan Atomic Energy Commission. And within this worst case scenario, which he put forward, it showed that, and particularly looking at the critical situation in reactor 4 at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant at the time, that there would also be the potential of having to evacuate an area of 250 kilometers around the Fukuichi nuclear power plant, which would include the area of Tokyo. This would mean a population of 50 million people having to evacuate. So this was included within the worst case scenario, which was put forward or calculated 2 weeks after the disaster. Therefore, in that sense, at the time of the disaster, of course,
had to keep in mind what would happen in this kind of worst case. And this is why, for example, when TEPCO said that they were going to withdraw from the site, why I stopped them from doing that. That was in order to prevent this worst case scenario from actually happening, from the scenario where we would have to have 50 million people fleeing or evacuating, including from Tokyo as well. So this was something really asking people to, well, put their lives on the line for that in order to prevent this worst scenario.
ピンチはチャンスっていう言葉があるんですけどね、日本は石油ショックっていう大ピンチを迎えたことあるんですよ。昭和48年だからね、1973年だな。それはアラブとイスラエルの第4次中東戦争を勃発すると、その勃発前はね、油の値段1バレル、油はバレルっていう単位を使いますね、キロじゃなくてね、リットルじゃなくて1バレル、まあリットルに直すと160キロ前後だっていうんだけども、1バレルね2ドル前後だったんです、日本で油。それがあの中東戦争を勃発したらね、一挙に10ドル跳ね上がって、で狂乱物価っていうインフレが起こったわけですよ。それがどんどんどんどん10ドルどころじゃない、20ドル30ドル50ドル、今から5、6年前なんと150ドルつけてましたよ、1バレル。ところがシェールガスが出てきた、アメリカで今ジャーッと、それだけ高いんだったらシェールガス、あ、そんな高くなくてですけどできるっていうのは、急に石油が安くなりましたね。で150ドル前後つけた油が今はもう40ドル前後下がってるでしょ。だこういうね、ピンチをチャンスにする、日本も石油に依存していたのをこんな高くなったんじゃということで省エネ技術が発達してきた、これピンチをチャンスにしたわけですよ。でこれからもね、今の、状況をピンチをチャンスに変える、いわゆる油に依存していた、そういうものを、自然エネルギーを活用しようというチャンスにするべき、そういう時期に来たと。ピンチはチャンスなんだと。自然エネルギーを活用して国民の生活の発展を競うという、そういう時代に来たんだなと受け止めた方がいいと思うんです。で、なんかイラク戦争の話出たね。
あ、じゃあそこまで先に通訳させ、そこまで通訳させていただきます。In Japan, we have a saying that a pinch is a chance, or you use a difficult circumstances as an opportunity. Of course, the oil shock here in Japan was what one such situation in the past, in the year 1973, at the time of the conflict between Israel and Arab countries as well, which meant that oil, which had been only about $2 a barrel, all of a sudden went up to 10, and then here in Japan went to 20, 30, even up to $250 from there as well. However, after this huge increase, inflation in the cost of oil, it meant that, for example, the United States went to develop shale gas or other methods of energy production, energy generation as well. And following this, it meant that the oil cost once again came down very much and went down to around $40 as in the past. So we have seen that Japan can, or the world can, use these difficult situations, these pinches, as a chance. After Japan's dependence on oil, for example, it used this instead to shift to more effective or efficient use of electricity, or less consumption of electricity, and so on as well. So using this as a positive opportunity. Therefore, I believe that the current situation as well is also the same. This is a time that we need to be looking at how to use this to change for the positive, rather than this dependence on oil and so on, use this as a change to utilize renewable energy and these new alternative energies more as well. So I think that this is the way that we can look at how to develop people's lives here in Japan, and in a way that fits the era that we are in today as an opportunity.
Yeah, the second question was about...
イラク戦争ね。これもね、まあ一般的に言うとアメリカはなんでイラク戦争を始めたんだと批判があったのが分かる。しかしね、イラクがね、さっさと認めていれば戦争起こらなかったんですよ。なんでさっさと認めなかったのかと。隠してると思ったんだよ、アメリカ。結果、大量破壊機なかったんだけども、イラクがさっさと認めれば、国連でも決意してるんだから、 受け入れれば戦争起こらなかったんです。そういうことがあるからね、やっぱりいろんな事情よく考えてね、これからの世界どうやって平和にしていくかと、うん、無駄な戦争、まあ無駄でない戦争なんかないと思うけども、やっぱり戦争をいかに回避していくかということは国際社会これからも一番大事なことだと思いますけどね。
And in regards to Iraq, of course, we look at the question of why it was the United States started the war on Iraq. And I can indeed understand that there is criticisms about this. But for me, the question is, well, why did Iraq not allow inspections to take place then, if they indeed did not have weapons of mass destruction, as it became clear? If they had allowed inspections to take place in the first place, as had been agreed upon at the United Nations, then it would not have led to this war as well. When we consider, of course, these different circumstances, when we think about how we can build peace and how to avoid any unnecessary wars, of course any kind of war is something which is indeed a waste. So this is a really fundamental, a priority issue for the international community to think about together.
Okay, I ask the last two gentlemen in the room, please be very quick. Okay? Yeah, you will be there.
Hello, Etienne Balmer from the French press agency AFP. One question from both of, for both of you. I wanted to know, beyond the nuclear and industry lobby in Japan, do you think that the strong ties, economic and political ties with the United States, is also maybe hampering Japan from stopping being a nuclear state? Thank you.
AFP 通信のものです。お二人にお伺いしたいんですけれども、まあ、先ほどの原子力村原子力ロビー以外にも日本のアメリカとの強い経済的または政治的なつながり関係というのは、まあ、脱原発を、まあ、あの妨害しているというようなことはありますでしょうか。
あの私は現状においてはそれはないと感じておりません。あのつまりは日本自身の選択だというふうにあのアメリカも理解をあの考えておられるというふうに私は受け止めています。
Personally, I think that in the current situation, I do not feel that that is the case. I think that this is a decision which is up to Japan, and this is something which the United States would also understand.
どうかです。
The same position.
Very good.Okay, last question from the floor, and then I have a few questions.
で、これで会場からの最後の質問で、次はオンラインの方に移ります。
My name is Patrick Walter with German newspaper Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. Two very short questions to both of you. First, what do you think should be done with the water in Fukushima Daiichi? Should it be put into the ocean, or should it...What would you propose to do with that? And the second question, Abe-san had the idea to build something like a hydrogen society in Japan. What do you think of that concept? Is this a vision or is it a realistic way to go forward? Thank you.
はい、ドイツの新聞のウェルターと申します。2つほどお二人に伺いいたします。1つ目は福島第一原発にある汚染水をどういうふうに、まあ、処理すべきなのか、海に放出すべきかどうかも含めてお伺いいたします。そして2つ目の方なんですけれども、あの安倍さんの方があの水素社会などをあの提言されているかと思いますが、それについてのコメントがあれば。あの水素の社会をまあ、提案されていると思いますが、それについてのコメントをお願いいたします。
まずあの汚染水、まあ、リチウム、あのトリチウム水のことで、まあ、私もいろんなあの勉強会に出てます。で、まあ、やはりあのそれを流すと風評被害であの漁業者が非常にあの打撃を受ける可能性があるので、できることなら他の方法であの処理すべきだと思っておりますが、あの他の方もなかなか難しいということもよく理解してますが、基本的にはそのように思ってます。
So first of all, in regards to the issue of the contaminated water, the containing tritium, I'm also participating in different sessions and so on to research and study about this. And I think that if this water is to be released into the ocean due to the so-called harmful rumors or fuhyo higai, which would spread as a result of this, it would have a serious impact on the local fishing industries. Therefore, other methods should be pursued as much as possible. However, at the same time, I do also acknowledge that perhaps deciding upon another method which is suitable for this is indeed challenging.
それからあの水素社会という問題は、まあ、先ほど冒頭申し上げたその再生可能エネルギーによって、日本が使用する電力の2倍、がこの生み出せる、まあ、理論上そうなるわけですけれども、そういう余ったあの電力を使ってそれを水素に変えると、で水素に変えた上でですね、あのまたあのいろんな形で活用すると、まあ、そういう意味ではあの水素社会というものと再生可能エネルギーというのは非常にこの何て言いましょうか、融合というかですね、あの組み合わせることによって、日本の未来のエネルギーの、まあ、全てを供給できると思っています。
And in regards to the hydrogen society as proposed, I think that if we look at renewable energy, as I stated previously, in theory, it would be possible to generate twice Japan's energy needs by utilizing or having full utilization of renewable energy. And therefore, in this kind of scenario, if we could look at using some of the surplus energy which is produced through this and converting it to hydrogen, it could be then used in different forms, in different ways within society as well. So I think that the combination of the hydrogen or hydrogen society and renewable energy is indeed something very complementary, something which would have a positive effect if used together. So this is something which is important to consider for Japan's energy future.
Okay, we have now to go not so many minutes, but this is a very important situation. So I...
what? 今のご質問、小泉先生も。
Okay, 小泉先生。I'm sorry.
福島の潜水、これは放流すると放水するとこれは漁業者が大反対ですからね、当分の間どうやったら汚染水を安定のないような形で処理するかということはもっと時間をかけて研究しなきゃいけないと思いますね。どうやって保管するかもあるから、いずれにしても地面にうずめるにしても海に流すにしても将来どういう技術が出てくるか、十分研究していかなきゃいけない問題だと思っています。
First of all, in regards to the contaminated water, of course, the local fishermen are very much against the idea of releasing this into the water. I think that for the time being, it is very important to fully research how this should be treated and stored safely as well. Either way, whether it ends up that the decision is made to release or to bury or to store in different ways as well, there may be also future technologies, future ways that come out about how this should be done as well. Therefore, I think it's important that there is indeed thorough or full research Done to look into this.
水素ですけどね、これ今私車水素自動車使ってるんですよ。ただね、ガソリンスタンドに比べてね、供給が少ないんだね。東京じゃね、水素供給してるスタンド3つしかないんだよ。ガソリンあちこちなんだけど、でガソリンの使ってるところに水素供給もやればいいと思うんだけども、土地関係の関係でね、またガソリンよりも保存の金がかかると作る。そこで遅れてるんだけども、いずれ水素自動車乗ってるけど快適ですよ。長く持つしね、スピードは別に落ちないし、この水素CO2も出さないしね、安全対策をしっかりやって増やしていければいいなと思ってます。まあピンチをチャンスに変える新しい技術がね、そういう、チャンスに変える一つの大きな技術進歩をもたらせばいいなと思ってます。
And in regards to hydrogen, I myself am actually using a hydrogen car. However, if you compare the number of places where you can supply, or where that is supplied here in Tokyo compared to a usual gas station, it's very, very few. There's actually only 3 places here in Tokyo which can serve hydrogen cars as well. I think in theory, you know, it should be that all petrol stations are also providing this hydrogen as well, but because of issues, for example, more costs to be saving or storing that on site and so on, there are not very many places which have opted for that. However, I would say that the car is very comfortable. Its speed is very safe. Of course, it has no CO2 emissions. There's very good safety measures in place. So this is a good example of what I mentioned before, the pinch becoming a chance, developing this new kind of technology and having progress as a way to move forward.
Thank you very much. I think in Fukushima right now, in Namie, there is the biggest factory of hydrogen. So maybe Koizumi sensei can go and join
them. 今福島県の浪江町の方にも水槽を作っているところがあると思いますので、ぜひ小泉先生もそちらの方にぜひ行ってみてください。
Okay, now we have a few questions from people who are following this conference online. Let me just, you know, try to resume them. One is from New York Times correspondent. How would you judge the efforts of the Japanese government in these last 10 years toward the decommissioning of the reactors in Fukushima? If you could give a kind of score.
はい、次はオンラインの方に届いている質問なんですが、まず最初はニューヨークタイムズからの質問です。この10年間での、日本政府の福島第一での廃炉の、プログレス、廃炉の過程をどういうふうに評価されるのかということなんですけれども、もし例えば点数をつけるとしたら何点というふうに評価されますでしょうか。
From 0 to 10.
0と10まで。
点数はつけられません。
I cannot put a score on it.
つまり簡単にはできないことを比較的短期間でできるというふうに言ってることが一番問題です。
I think that the biggest issue is that they are saying that they will be doing something in a rather short time span, which is something not easy to do within the timeline which is being stated.
つまりメルトスルーして格納容器の底にあるそのデブリという存在は、私が見るところですね、例えばチェルノブイリでもこれから100年ぐらいはですね、この金属のシールドをかけて放射能が下がるのを待つというふうに言っているのを見ると、同じようなことが必要になるのではないか。つまり極めて長期間そのデブリをどっかにその今のところにこう閉じ込めておくしかないのではないかと。それに代わる手当が簡単には見つかるとは思いません。そういう意味で今のいろいろ政府がこうなってるああなってるというこの報告はほとんどは希望的観測で事実に即していないと思っています。
For example, if we look at the situation where in the reactors there has been the melt through and there is still the highly radioactive debris located on site there as well. If we see what's happening within the decommissioning process in Chernobyl, it's said that in order to remove some of these, they need to wait for a span, for example, of 100 years before the levels have lowered enough to safely remove the debris. I think that it is likely that a similar kind of situation will be needed at Fukuichi as well. This is something which will be a very long term process in regards to the decommissioning of the plant. When we see, for example, what will be needed to be done to contain the debris where it is located now before it can be fully removed from the site as well. This is not something which there are easy or short-term options which can be implemented for as well. Therefore, I would say in my evaluation that a lot of the government's reports about how this progress is going and so on is rather just optimistic or hopeful statements rather than based on reality.
小泉先
生。核のゴミの処分場、これは 日本のみならず世界困ってるんですね。で、私数年前世界でたった一つ核のゴミ、原発の供給した後の核のゴミを処分している場所があるっていうんでフィンランド行ってきましたよ。いわゆるオンカロっていうんですね、あの核のゴミの処理する捨て場所、世界でそのフィンランドしかやってないという。でフィンランド岩盤でできている国ですけどね、約400メートル地下を掘って、そして2000メーターほどの広場にそこに核のゴミを数万年放射能が漏れないように処分するということ、これ見てね、これは日本も大変だと、いずれね核のゴミの処分場を作んなきゃいけないんだけども、だからこそねもう原発はやらない、これ以上増やさない、そういう前提でやらないとなかなか国民の、ね、理解とか支持得られないと思いますね。大変なことですよ。その400メートル掘って2キロの四方の広場、そこに埋めるって言うんだから、フィンランドだから岩盤でできて地震津波がないって言うんだからいいですけどね、日本は地震国ですからね、400メートル掘ったらね水どころか温泉が出てきちゃうんじゃないかね、これ作るの大変ですよね。だそれだけ大変なことなんですよ、あの核のゴミの処分場を作るのは。これは早くねやめて、いずれどこに処分場を作るか、これは大変な問題ですね。それだけに早くやめた方がいいと思ってます。
In regards to the issue of nuclear waste, once again to come to the issue of spent fuel disposal sites and so on, this is a huge issue both for Japan and for the entire world as well. Several years ago, I had the opportunity to go to the place where there is the only such, or the only spent fuel disposal site in Finland, actually. This is a site called Onkaro, and this is the only one, the only such place in the world as well. Finland is a place where, because of the nature of the rock, the soil that that is built in as well, they have been able to build this. However, they had to dig down 400 meters underground and then create a space of an area of 2,000 meters, which is where this spent fuel is now being stored. It's also said that it will have to be kept there for several tens of thousands of years as well to ensure that, and also to ensure that radiation does not leak from there. So when I saw this, I really realized what a significant challenge this is for Japan as well. Japan, so the first thing that we need to do is to ensure that we are not creating more spent fuel, that we are not creating more of this nuclear waste as well. And when we think about, you know, for Japanese people, for example, to accept, you know, where this kind of site should be located is indeed very challenging as well. To find somewhere that it's possible to dig down 400 meters and then have a 2 kilometer space there as well. In a country like Finland, which has no earthquakes and tsunamis and so on, it may have been possible, but Japan is a completely different situation given its disaster-prone nature as well. If you were also to dig down that far in Japan, you would probably be coming up with, you know, onsen, hot springs and these sorts of things as well. So it's very difficult to find this kind of location there. So I think it's extremely important. Well, first of all, we have these unresolved questions about what to do with the spent fuel, what to do with the nuclear waste. And so without deciding upon this, we cannot go on that path.
Oh, time is running away, but since we started 10 minutes later, do you agree to stay 10 minutes more? So I can ask all the questions.
開始の方がちょっと10分ほど遅れましたので、できれば10分ほど延長したいですが、よろしいでしょうか?
Okay, another question from online.In order to accelerate getting out of nuclear power and expanding the use of renewable energies, would you favor taking renewable energy policy out of the hands of the Agency for Natural Resources and Energy and creating a new independent ministry for natural and renewable energy along the lines, for example, of India?
はい、次もまたオンラインでの質問なんですが、お二人に答えていただきたいと思いますが、まあ、脱原発を早めて、そして自然エネルギーの活用を拡大していくためには、自然エネルギーの政策、まあ、戦略などを現在の資源エネルギー庁から新しい独立したような、まあ、省、または政府の省など、自然エネルギーのための新しい機関を作ることは、まあ、やった方がいいのか、例えばインドも同じようなことをされているかと思いますが、いかがでしょうか。
これはね、そんな難しいことじゃないと思うんです。総理大臣が辞めるって言えば辞められるんです。そういう総理を出さなきゃいかん。
I think that this is not actually a very difficult thing to do. If the Prime Minister were only to decide this, to make that a decision, then this could indeed be done. So this is what we need Suga to do.
冒頭の話の中でも言いましたように、私は再生可能エネルギーというのは、日本で言えば農林水産省が非常にですね、可能性を持ってると思ってます。まあ、そういう点で農林水産省、これも先ほど言いましたけれども、かつては薪とか炭という形でエネルギーを供給してた。それが石炭、石油、原発と変わって、もう一回薪や炭の代わりに再生可能エネルギーを供給する。それには農地の活用も十分に大きなポテンシャルがありますので、農林水産省に、頑張ってもらいたいというのが現時点での私の考えです。
So as I mentioned in my opening remarks as well, I think that the Ministry of Agriculture in Japan really holds or sees a great potential in renewable energy as well. The Ministry of Agriculture has also seen, you know, over the years, over the period, time periods in the past, we've moved from wood to coal to fossils and nuclear power and so on. So having the shift to move instead to renewable energy is a way also to utilize the full potential of the farmland which exists here in Japan as well. So in regards to my current way of looking at this, I think that it would be great for the Minister of Agriculture to play a significant role in promotion or the policy for renewable energy.
Okay, I have a question last from the floor, from the online. By the way, the last question, just for the record, was by Eric Johnson of Japan Times.
先ほどの質問、Japan Times のエリック・ジョンソン記者からの質問でした。
This one is from our colleague Ilgin, member of the board from BBC Turkey. Japan has been building nuclear power plants in other countries, and it's keeping advising on that, in Turkey, for example, UK, and they are stopped now due to cost and safety issues. If you would be right now Prime Minister of Japan, would you still promote export of nuclear power technology as a key pillar of your efforts to boost infrastructure sales in overseas markets?
次、BBC ワールドのトルコ語版の記者 の, イルギンさんからの質問になります。でこちらの方はですね、まあ、日本は海外での原発の建設を進めてきたんですけれども、例えばトルコやイギリスでの建設を進めてきたと思うんですけれども、コストの問題、そして安全性の問題で、そういったような計画は今は止まっています。もしお二人が現在、また総理大臣になれるのであれば、今も海外の市場での、まあ、インフラ販売の強化の柱として原子力の技術を海外に輸出することを推進されますでしょうか。
しないです。やめます。
No, I would stop.
That's the kind of question. Perfect.
実は私が総理の時で、この福島原発事故が起きる前、トルコに行った時に、トルコが原発を導入するならぜひ日本の原発を導入してほしいという。トップセールスをいたしました。まあ、現在は恥じております。これからは絶対しません。
Actually, when I was Prime Minister prior to the disaster in Fukushima, I went to Turkey and had these top sales discussions saying that if Turkey was to consider introducing nuclear energy for them to please buy this technology from Japan, this is something I am, of course, very much ashamed about now, and I would not do the same thing now.
Okay, tomorrow we will have Kurokawa sensei here in.
明日はこちらで Kurokawa 先生がこちらで会見をされる予定ですが。
A very quick judgment from both of you, especially from Kan-san, on his report.
あの黒川先生の、自己調の報告書をどういうふうに評価されるのかということを最後にコメント。あの当時 の黒川先生の自己調の当時の報告書をどういうふうに。
政府と。
The 国家 the diet one?
Yes, the case. Yes.、はい、the one about human responsibility.
そうですね。あの、まあ、人的なという点
で。あの私は黒川先生 の、 あの分析は非常にあの参考になったし勉強になったし。高く評価しています。特にあの原発事故という狭い範囲だけではなくて、やはりあの何て言いましょうか、日本社会の持っているこの、まあ、ある種の弱さのようなところまで踏み込んで分析されていることに非常にあの私にとっても大変な勉強になりました。
I very much highly evaluate Dr. Kurokawa's analysis, and in the report, it was something which I very much used as a reference and learned a lot from myself, particularly the fact that it looked not only within a narrow definition of the nuclear power plant disaster, but had a very deep analysis of the broader weaknesses of Japanese society was something which personally I very highly evaluate.
あの、Kurokawa 先生があの事故の後ね、国会に与野党全会一致で事故検証委員会作ったんですよ。その書を読みましたけどね、簡単に結論言いますけど、この黒川報告書の中でね、あの福島の事故の根源的原因は原発の安全性を監督監視する立場の経産省と監視される立場の原発会社、これが逆転した結果である。原子力規制委員会は原発会社の虜になったって書いてあるんだ。であれはやっぱりね、当時、きちんとした報告書なんだけど、あんまり報道されてないんだね。規制委員会専門家ですよね。その人たちがね、原発会社の虜になった、フォローになっちゃったと、そういうことだからね。
当時ではあの原子力安全保安員でした。
保安員
が今は
規制委員だけど、保安員
が当時の保安員。
だからこれからもね、そういうことがないようにね、今こそ原発の安全性っていうものに対して疑問の根を持ってる人たくさんいるから、早くやめた方がいいなと痛感しています。
Within Dr. Kurokawa's analysis after the disaster, well, first of all, the fact that there was a unanimous decision by all, both the ruling and opposition members of the parliament to set up this commission. And reading the report, she put very simply one of the main conclusions within that as the fundamental reason for the disaster at Fukushima was the fact that the positions or the agencies which are responsible for the monitoring of the safety on the nuclear power plant, that is what was at the time NISA, and those which were responsible or the ones which were on the side to be monitored, the utilities companies, they had actually almost reversed their positions. The fact, first of all, that this agency was within the METI as well, and that this was really just following the bidding of the utility companies as well, was one of the fundamental reasons which led to the disaster as well.That was something which perhaps was not reported or looked at as much as it should at the time. However, this issue of the regulations or the regulatory bodies and the monitoring system for safety was indeed one of the keys and which led to the change of what was NISA at the time being formed into a different agency as well. But what is really fundamental there to ensure that this does not happen again in the future, if we look at the safety issues of nuclear power, where there are still many, many questions and concerns remaining, is to look at how we can stop using it as soon as possible and move away from that. This is what I feel very strongly.
Thank you very much. You have been very good today in saying yes and no. Yes or no.
Kiwana.
The Olympics should be held in Japan July or not?
今日ははっきりと Yes と No の質問もたくさんあったと思うんですけれども、今年の7月に日本でオリンピックは開催すべきかされるべきかどうか Yes か No でお願いいたします。
頑張って
これは分かんないね、もうこういう状況だから。もともとね、私は8月っていうのはね最適の気候だって言って日本は持ってきたんですよ。これは嘘言っちゃいかんって言ってんだよ。よくまだあの人たちがね、8月は日本で気候が一番いい時期ですって持ってきた。逆じゃないかと、8月一番悪いよ。よくこういう嘘を抜け抜けと言ったなと呆れてたんですよ。あとのことちょっと言わないけどね。
This is, it's very difficult. And when we look at the current circumstances, it's hard to make a decision about that. But if we take the fact that when they called for the Olympics to be held in Japan, they said that August in Japan is the best climate to be holding the Olympics. But of course, this is completely false. It's the opposite. August is the worst time to be having the Olympics here in Japan. So that there were even these kind of lies about this kind of thing is something which, well, puts up some questions. And I will leave it at that.
Chan-san?
私非常に難しいと思ってます。
I think that it is extremely difficult.
反対というよりは非常に難しい。
Rather than when I am pro or against, it is extremely difficult.
This is a question I cannot ask Kan-san, but to Koizumi-san, yes. Since you are anti-nuclear, would you support as a, next prime ministerMr. Kono, who is anti-nuclear.
でこれはカン先生に伺いすることができない内容なんですけれども、まあ、脱原発という立場で次の総理大臣として河野太郎さんを支持されますでしょうか、小泉先生。
支持しますよ。
Okay. Yes, I would.
Thank you very much.
ありがとうございます。
Okay, this is on behalf of the Foreign Correspondent Club of Japan. You are both now members, honorary members.And you can come here anytime. Well, until the emergency, you can stay until 7 o'clock. Afterwards, you can come. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you